Morning, everyone. Take a moment here while Kevin's getting this all set up. Thank you all for letting me be here today. It's a hard act to follow. One of the speakers in the earlier part of the program wanted to sort of take note of how fortunate San Benito County is in terms of having great water resources to rely upon. Someone who comes from the San Joaquin Valley and someone who gets to work in the political realm sometimes, I also think you should count yourselves lucky to have fine, pragmatic, problem-solving representatives like Assemblymember Caballero and Congressman Benito. So another reason to hold yourselves as fortunate. I'm going to spend a little bit of time on a brief overview about California's water situation as it applies to the Central Valley Project, but before I do that, I'd like to spend a moment talking about the San Luis Delta-Mendota Water Authority, who we are and what we do.
The red stripe.
Oh, there we go. The CVP facilities and the State Water Project facilities, those are the major projects in the state. Of course, there are many, many other projects, from regional projects like Hetch Hetchy that carries water from Yosemite Park to the city of San Francisco to your local supplies. And so California is very much a hydraulic society. There was a question earlier about the imported water and where that comes from. The Central Valley Project's major reservoirs are up in the north. There's Trinity Reservoir on the Trinity River, and it brings water from the Trinity Basin into the Sacramento and Central Valley. There's the Shasta Reservoir by Redding, which is the largest reservoir in the state. The federal government also has the Folsom Reservoir east of Sacramento, the Malonis Reservoir, which is east of the city of Stockton, and the Fryant Dam Reservoir, which is east of the city of Fresno. There was a question about Shasta Dam and enlargement. There are, in fact, five projects that are being evaluated for either construction or enlargement. The Shasta Dam raise is one of them. The proposal would be to raise Shasta Dam approximately 18 feet, more or less the height of the bridge that's there if you've ever crossed Interstate 5. And that project, I think, is sitting kind of in abeyance right now. There's the Sykes Reservoir, as Assemblymember Caballero was talking about. There's the expansion of Los Vaqueros. There's the expansion of Fryant Dam, a project called Temperance Flat. And then there's the expansion of San Luis Reservoir. So those are the major reservoir projects that are in play right now. The authority service area is pretty vast and it's very diverse. Our northern border is essentially the Bay Delta itself, and to the south, it's basically Highway 41 at Kettleman City. To the east, it's roughly the San Joaquin River. And of course, we serve these areas here in the west, San Benito and Santa Clara counties. Assemblymember Caballero had pointed out that 25 million people, more or less, rely on their water coming through the Delta. It also supplies water to seven of the nation's top 10 agricultural producing counties and the second largest contiguous wetlands in the United States after the Everglades. Our oldest water rights users are referred to as the exchange contractors. They began developing their rights and water infrastructure in the 1880s. I like to think of our oldest water users as being the multitude of wildlife that utilize the wildlife refuge complexes out in and around the Los Banos area. Our largest urban area, of course, is Silicon Valley and in the Santa Clara area. And then, but we also serve a number of small agricultural disadvantaged communities throughout the San Joaquin Valley. So it's a very diverse area that we support. On the water supply update side, I think the headlines have pretty well said it all. I mean, we were sitting in the most remarkable winter any of us have seen. In most parts of the state, it is record-setting, and so it's been quite phenomenal. I think if you asked anyone several months ago, would we get out of the hole that this five-year drought had created in 1 year, the universal answer would have been no. And so, what a difference 8 months makes. This is San Luis Reservoir in August of last year. Those are the intakes, not taking so much. It looks very much like a barge. taking on material today. So a remarkable change of events, as Jeff Catania reported earlier. Central Valley Project customers will receive 100% supply this year. That's great in one sense. It's disappointing in the sense that that's the first time in 11 years that that's happened. And it's a problem, actually, that I'll probably focus mostly on going forward. There's a paradox in all of this, right? We have this 100% supply. Can we put it to use? That's a difficult story to tell. There's also this issue about regulation and what parts of the drought will stay with us. I thought the Capitol Press said it very well when they noted that Governor Brown declares drought over, issues conservation orders. Well, that's rather paradoxical, isn't it? But as one of our earlier speakers had talked about, we don't know what next year is going to bring and years after. So we simply cannot get comfortable with the bounty that nature has given us this year. We do need to plan for a different future, and we need to work hard to make that future something different than what the past has been. And so I want to talk about that a little bit. Jeff had mentioned this number earlier, this 35%. This is really what Central Valley Project ag customers have received over the last 10 years or so. So far cry from 100%. And an issue that is driving to the problem Congressman Panetta had noted earlier, one being of repayment. The way the Central Valley Project is to be repaid is through the delivery of water, and when the Central Valley Project isn't delivering water, those rates are going to go up because the deadline isn't moving. So it is a significant problem that we do have to take on, and I appreciate him recognizing that. So how did we get to 75%? And really, it comes down to a series of decisions that have been made over the last quarter century. Each one of these bars, you don't need to know what each bar is, but each one of these bars represents a decision, a policy choice that was made to implement a regulation intended to protect or restore something somewhere. Each one individually has been defended successfully. Each one individually, I think, you know, as reasonable people, we could sit down and acknowledge the potential benefit. But we haven't sat down and really thought about what the cumulative effect of these quarter century decisions has been, and what has meant that we haven't added any new storage, we haven't added any new conveyance, we haven't added much by way of water supply to help offset the over 3.5 million acre feet of water that we've dedicated from previous sort of human uses, if you will, environmental management. I think what is most frustrating for folks who are dependent on Central Valley Project water about this rededication of supply isn't only just the financial impacts, right? The rates are going up and over time, but it's the fact that we have, over this quarter of a century, not achieved the goals that we set out to achieve. 25 years ago, the Fish and Wildlife Service listed the Delta smell. And here we are, a quarter century later, and many believe that they're on the brink of extinction. 25 years ago, more or less, National Marine Fisheries Service listed winter run salmon. And we're in a similar situation where you know, the plight of salmon and sadly the fishermen that depend upon them is quite dire. And so a lot of investment made, not much return on investment. And a lot of socioeconomic disruption as a result, particularly in the San Joaquin Valley. But I think all communities that receive water from the Central Valley Project and the State Water Project, for that matter, have felt some form of this. Higher rates, you know, having to rely more on groundwater, other issues. And, you know, it's I think the most difficult part about this is the fact that, you know, well-intended people have gone out and tried to solve some really difficult problems, and we haven't gotten there. And I think what is an important thing to just simply keep in mind is that despite the expenditure of literally billions of dollars, right, billions, dedication of millions of acre feet, untold socioeconomic disruption, we haven't been able to protect the species we've aimed to protect. And the choices, or the place that we've ended up to today is really the result of choices. This isn't a natural disaster that has brought us here. It wasn't a single decision that has brought us here. It's been a parade of decisions that have brought us here. And so I think we're standing at a very crucial time in terms of how do we move forward. Do we want the next quarter century to look like the last one? And I would argue no. And as Henry Ford reminded us, failure is simply the opportunity to begin again, this time more intelligently. And Henry did a lot of good things very well. So, what's needed? I'm going to begin with an honest dialogue about scientific uncertainty and about policy choices. There's this circuit, this insidious circuit that we end up in the regulated world, where you have scientists, curious people by nature, and love smart people, and they ask questions, right? And they come up with hypotheses, which is just a really fancy word for an idea. And they think, you know, what if? And there's lots of mays and coulds and caveats and qualifiers. And they pursue that idea. Well, a regulator gets to a point where something needs to be done. They're not quite sure what that something is. And so they grab these baskets of ideas and they convert them from a scientific method to a regulation, which is just a hard box, right? And so the shalls and coulds and maybes becomes wills and shalls and fixed points. And then we fast forward 10 or 15 or 25 years, and the intended outcomes aren't achieved, they're not even demonstrable. And so when we ask about that, what are we told? Well, it's complicated. Well, it wasn't so complicated when you wrote the regulation, but it's complicated now. And the other part of that that's insidious is that we haven't set in place the science and the monitoring programs that would help us demonstrate as we move forward through time if those original decisions we made are actually contributing to the solution. And so we find ourselves at a great disadvantage at this point in time with huge gaps in knowledge, huge scientific uncertainty, and we need to address that head on if we're going to be more successful going forward. The other part about policy choices is not conflating science and policy. A lot of times it will be presented to us in the world, well, the science says we must. You know, even if the science is perfect, there are other factors that have to be taken into consideration. And so I think it's important for us to be clear when we're talking science and we're talking policy. My second point, I'm going to echo Congressman Panetta here. It's got to be greater collaboration and partnerships. For too long, we've had interests sitting in silos, sometimes shooting at each other, sometimes declaring they've got the solution, usually to the loud cry of anyone else who's on the other side of the issue. But greater collaboration partnerships, they're hard, which is why people don't like to do them, but they're necessary if we're going to solve these intractable problems. Accountability for environmental management actions. Every water manager in this room today and beyond the four walls of this building have to account for where every drop goes and what it does. If it's delivered to a farm, if it's delivered to a wildlife refuge, if it's delivered to a house, a factory, every drop is accounted for, except for environmental water use, right? And it's the fastest growing sector of water use in the state, and it's the only sector that we don't have any requirements about the accountability. If we dedicate million acre-feet to this solution, how many fish are we going to get? And if we don't get them, then what are we going to do? Lastly, regulatory reform and permitting reform, clearly important areas where we can improve the status quo. The elephant in the room is this. We are confined in large part by the Endangered Species Act, and specifically Section 7, which essentially requires the federal government to evaluate the decisions it makes. And the way it's set up is they have to kind of evaluate those decisions discreetly. And so you end up with these single stressor, single problem, single fish sort of solutions, and sometimes they confound each other, right? There's a great example, the biological opinion for the Fish and Wildlife Service, biological opinion for Delta Smelt says, do not, Bureau of Reclamation, put a barrier here on the San Joaquin River. The National Marine Fisheries Service biological opinion for salmon says, absolutely, Bureau of Reclamation, put a barrier here on the San Joaquin River. These are the sort of confounding situations we find ourselves in the Section 7 world. The other part of the Endangered Species Act that can work quite a bit better, I would argue, would be Section 10, which is a conservation planning element, where we're stepping back and we're looking at things at an ecosystem level, and we're trying to solve problems comprehensively. And we've been told that this is the path forward ever since we began what I would define as the regulatory era. Most recently, we have Public Policy Institute of California acknowledging there's no single cause for the decline of these bay-billed fisheries. That's true. The National Academy of Sciences said the same thing about 6 years earlier. Numerous independent science panels and peer reviews have drawn the exact same conclusion, and yet, much to our peril, we continue to ignore this good advice. And so, I think moving forward, if we're going to do better for fish, we're going to do better for farms and families, we need to take this advice. So lastly, you know, why is it important, right? And sure, you know, California grows about half of the nation's fruits, nuts, and vegetables. That is awesome, right? We've got 7 of the nation's top 10 egg-producing counties. That is awesome. But there's a lot more to it than just that, isn't there? I mean, we as Californians, most Californians, right? Most Californians are supportive of, you know, a living wage, as it's often described. We have some of the best paid farm workers in the world. If we're importing our food, you know, what are they making? We have other social values that we're undermining, right? Worker safety, child labor laws, food safety. Right? We have the most aggressive food safety programs in the world. You can eat out of any farmer's field in California. Right? Pesticide safety, greenhouse gas emissions. And so, over the last quarter century, hundreds, thousands of people have lined up trying to do the right thing to protect certain fish species. And for a variety of reasons, we have failed. We have come to a place where they are worse off than ever. In the meantime, families and farms that are dependent on the Central Valley Project, they're only getting 35% of the supply that they signed up for. And they're still paying the bill for 100%. And in addition, we've sat down and created a world where, while we're trying to focus on one aspect of the problem, this false paradigm of fish versus farms, right? It's just a complete absurd caricature. We've also undermined a whole series of other social values that we hold important. And so for these reasons, I argue that moving forward, we're going to be able to take on these challenges, not only fish management, but better water management. You know, the essential pieces of that are comprehensive solutions, better collaboration, acknowledging scientific uncertainty, and having honest debates about the policy choices that are being made along the way. So I appreciate your time and attention today and look forward to any questions.